I've been working full time for 2 years, and
mm-hmm.
in that time, my salary has almost doubled from when I started to where I am now.
Hello, Belivies. Welcome to Community Living with your girl, Malebo. If you're new to the channel, please remember to subscribe. And if you're stopping back by, you know the jingle by now, so sing along with us. Welcome back. So thank you to each and everyone that's been subscribing, liking, commenting, and sharing. You know the deal. We're on our way to 13,000 subscribers, so yay. So with me, I have the lovely from the Tsogofatso channel. Well, she'll introduce herself later on. Today, we're talking about young professionals that are doing extremely good things in their fields, and she will be sharing her journey as a young professional with us. We're going to do, as you all know, we start off with prayer on this channel. So we're going to start off with prayer. Let's just bow our head or close our eyes, whatever works for you. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for your good God. Thank you, Father, for the connections that we're able to make. And also the guest that we have today for her time, for availing herself, for sharing her knowledge. May you bless our Lord Father in all her endeavors. And may the knowledge that she shares with the audience, O Lord Father, may it be beneficial to whoever is watching at home. We thank you, and may this platform continue, O Father, to be a place where we share your word, where we share your wisdom, and where we just build a community that is that fears you and loves you, in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As I mentioned, we have the lovely Tsogofatso. She's like a slasher of note. She does so many things. But today she's going to be telling us about her journey as a software engineer. So please introduce yourself.
Hi, everyone. I am Tsogofatso Isaac, and I have a YouTube channel called The Tsogofatso. So I am a content creator, entrepreneur, and a software developer. So on my channel, I just like to share my journey on all of this thing.
Okay, thank you for joining us today. How would you describe your career or your position currently as someone that's working in the software engineering world? How would you describe it without like Google definition, more of like your experience and so forth?
So I currently work as a front-end software engineer, so I kind of work on the things that you see. So I work on a mobile app that's quite popular here in South Africa. So stuff like what happens when you click the button, what happens when you go onto the screen, and so on. Yeah, so I do all the code behind that. Yeah.
Okay, and how long have you been doing that for?
I've been working full-time as a software engineer for 2 years now. I just reached 2 years on the 1st of March. So,
yay. How does one become a specialist in your field? So if I'm not sure what kind of levels there are to software engineering, and how does one become a specialist? You can take us from like grassroots level. What do you need to study? Maybe high school, varsity, and so forth. Any certifications that are there that you need to get as well?
I think within like being a software developer, there's so many different fields, but there are also lots of different ways to get there. So I like to kind of highlight those on my channel. My personal journey, I went to the University of Pretoria and I studied computer science for 3 years. So that's one way to do it. I know some people attend boot camps, other people do like a 1 year diploma and so on. So I think it can be different for everyone. And there's no, I don't think there's like a wrong or right way. Some companies prefer for
a specific way.
Yeah, so I'd say the first step would be to kind of get some kind of qualification or education, not necessarily like a qualification. But after that, you also have to know, I think, have an idea of which route you want to go. Because I'm a mobile developer, so I work on mobile apps. So maybe you would want to go into the back end. Maybe you want to go into web development. Maybe you want to go into like networks and stuff like that. So I think first step is kind of, but it's also nice when you study, you get exposed to all
to
these
all
different
these
things. And then that's where you can see which one that you like. But I think most.
I think that's the question I wanted to ask just now. Say that with the field being so big and not knowing where to start, is it best to do those boot camps, or is it best to go the getting a qualification like what you did? So which one is the best route in your experience, and from what like you've seen in the industry, are people thriving more after like, you know, they get their 3 year qualification, 4 year qualification, or if they do their mini boot camps? Or it depends on the person.
I think it depends on the person and where you're trying to take your career, because for example, some of the bigger companies, they just want to see a degree. So you kind of need that. Like with boot camps, I know people say it's a whole lot of information at once. It's super intense. So if that's not your learning style, that will be very challenging and it won't be for you. So yeah, I think honestly, I don't have the exact answer, but it depends on you. But I think it's just good to know that there are all these different
ways. Yes. Okay. And are companies in SA welcoming of the bootcamp route from your experience?
Yeah, from my experience, I've seen it. Even where I work, there's people that have that are self-taught, and but I know there's platforms online that are aimed at hiring developers and so on. And some of the platforms will tell you that we want some type of qualification, either a degree, diploma, or something. So it also depends on where you go. What I always say is just try everything. Because even with myself, I got my first job when I was in my final year. Yeah. So I was already working before I had the actual qualification. I'm working with people. Some people self-taught, some people have degrees, some people are doing their masters. So it really varies. Yeah, okay. I think what's important to note also, I'm not sure if you already have this question, but also a lot of the interviews include a technical element. So if you have the skills and you can show that you have the skills.
You have the skills. Yeah, that's what they care more about versus just what's on paper.
Yes.
Okay. So I think it's very important to note that the technical aspect of your skills will be assessed at some point for most interviews, right?
It's either where you have to write a test. It's questions and answers. It's either they give you it's kind of an assignment where they can build an app to solve the solution, or they won't give.
Do they expect graduates to already do that? Is it not as technically intensive to be able to do that?
Not quite, because I think for me, with my experience in varsity, a lot of our already projects, assignments and tests is already real world things, and they kind of just want to see your way of thinking. Sometimes it's actually way easier than the work we do in varsity. Yeah, they just want to see how will you actually do the solution. And other interviews, though, they kind of test you while you're online, so ask you a question.
And do they want a working solution, it needs to work, is that how maybe you pass, or they just want to see how you think, how far do you need to be in terms of the solution,
From my experience, I'm also still I've always applied for junior roles. So from my experience, it's always been a simple solution, something that's not impossible. It's just mostly to see because there's lots of different ways to do something. So they want to see also, will you ask for help if you're stuck? How did you actually structure your things? Is it a messy code where people won't understand
what you're doing?
Because you need to remember you're also working with people. They need to understand how you're naming your variables. So think simple things like that. Kind of see if you're a team player.
And so we spoke about the qualification. What about the certifications? I don't know if you've already covered it. What type of certificates do you need to get?
I think it depends on your role again, because when I worked my first job, I was going to do my AWS certification because we were using that at that job, but currently I'm not using that. So it doesn't apply to me right now. So I think but I would like to learn more and get certified in other areas, but I always want it to be something that's relevant and will help me out in my career, not just to stack them up. There's lots of them. I'm always seeing they are on LinkedIn. People are
are you using it though?
I don't personally, outside of my degree, I don't have any other qualifications, but I'd like to get there, but I always want it to be something that's going to help me out in my career.
So far you haven't basically identified one you need right now?
Not at the moment. Because recently I just took a course on Udemy because I was learning a new programming language. So that was just for me.
Is there a new programming language to learn?
It's not new in the sense it just came, but I'm a front end developer, so I wanted to upskill to become a full stack developer. So I had to learn Golang
I thought there was another language now.
New things and AI, all these things.
What made you choose software engineering over all the other careers that are out there?
It started quite a while ago. I used to have a blog. I used to talk about fashion, other random things, and I saw my blog was kind of boring, mm-hmm. and I saw the people's blogs. Like, this looks nice. Mm-hmm. How do they do that? And that's when I learned HTML and CSS. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, this is cool. If I put these, you know, characters, it looks like this on the website. And I started learning web development. And I started.
How old were you?
I was about 15, 16.
Oh wow!
Yeah, it was before. I remember it was before grade 10, because that's what made me choose IT when I went to. Yeah, I think I was 14, grade 9. Yeah, and then that's it. And then I took IT in grade 10. I mm-hmm. enjoyed it. And I'm like, okay, I guess this is it. Because I was also trying to do some coding outside of school. Like, I once made a game. I mm-hmm. did some web development. And yeah, so then that's how I went
to study. I think that's how I actually got to see your channel. Okay. Because you were sharing, like, different ways where you can try to be a developer and stuff like that from like grass university level, and I found it very interesting. Yeah. I'm like, oh, she's already doing the work. This is so interesting. So yeah, that's nice. The money and opportunity to grow in software engineering, though.
Yes, I think there mm-hmm. is. I think it's a good industry to be in. As I said, I've been working full time for 2 years, and mm-hmm. in that time, my salary has almost doubled from when I started to where mm-hmm. I am now. So there's definitely room for growth. I still even identify as a junior developer. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to now go to the next level. But like as I say, there's also like there's team leads and there's all these opportunities to grow. I think
Okay. And then as a junior developer, what kind of tasks are you usually assigned? Is it like the same as everybody, or like you get less challenging tasks?
It's pretty much the same as everybody, but I'd say I'm more able to ask for help. Like, you know, there's things that can be like, get in touch with the senior developer, like, hey, mm-hmm. how do you think I should approach this solution type of thing? Okay. So usually it's not, they don't separate the tasks they're delivering to us, but I think they allow me, give me the space to reach out for help. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can you start a business with the knowledge that you gain, and when do you feel like you can start your own thing?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Yeah, because mm-hmm. I also do my own thing now. I do freelance web development. So I think what's really great about mm-hmm. this career is that you can really just do your own thing if you mm-hmm. want to. So I think
from the get-go,
because mm-hmm. I also have some of like my schoolmates that are doing their own thing now. Mm. You know, so
they're not in like firms.
Yeah, I think it all, because personally for me, I wanted to do that, but then I had a hard time with clients, you know. So I think it also depends on like your personality. Mm-hmm. But I think you have the skills to, for example, you're able to build apps, you're able to build mm-hmm. websites, which are things that people are usually looking for.
A lot of businesses need them, whether they're big or small. So
I think the most important part is finding the right clients, mm-hmm. because sometimes, not discriminate against anyone, but like small business owners, there's not a lot of money to spend mm-hmm. there, you know. But those are the people, if you're on social media, that those are the clients you're most likely to find. People starting mm-hmm. out, you know, and they're also expecting starting out prices, you know. So that's usually when you're starting out building your portfolio. But I think, you know, people have the end goal of the big corporates to make mm-hmm. their platforms, make their apps. So I think mm-hmm. that's where a lot of the money is, but it's mm-hmm. hard to get there.
Okay, sorry to put you on the spot, but if you're not comfortable, it's okay if you don't answer it.
Yeah.
But how much would you charge like a small business for developing their app or something like that? What is the range looking like?
Yeah, I think it's said I'd rather answer for a website, because I think apps have so many different functionalities. Mm-hmm. It needs to be like on my, but for my personal, I do freelance work, and mm-hmm. I charge from 5,000 rands
for a website.
Yes. Yeah. So just a basic website with just like about us, information, contact form. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then the more advanced type of websites, what is the range looking like?
That would depend. Because, for example, mm-hmm. you would tell me, like, okay, maybe looking for, I don't know, like an Airbnb type of website for people mm-hmm. to put their homes and whatever. So I need to look at all the functionality. But mm-hmm. I have been trying not to take on such big projects mm-hmm. because it's a lot of work. And I currently do everything on my own. And mm-hmm. that's what's working for me. I could maybe get some help from other people. Mm-hmm. But just doing everything on myself is what works. So I just kind of stick to the...
So small. Any last remarks for the audience at home regarding software engineering, and also please share your social media handles with us.
Okay. I think it's a really great industry to be in. I think if you're looking to become a software developer, software engineer, I think it's all about building your portfolio. So either on GitHub, putting your projects up on GitHub, or creating your own personal website. Because how I got my first job, they found me on Twitter because I had a personal portfolio and they could see the projects that I had done. Even now, they'd probably ask you to submit like your GitHub link where you can see your projects and your code. So just build up some type of portfolio. And also, I also often get asked like, what type of projects should you work on? I think it also depends on which route you want to take. So if you want to be like a mobile developer, work on a mobile app, put it there. If you want to be a web developer, put like a make a website, put it on there. So it just depends on what you're trying to accomplish and kind of show off those projects. I mean, you can do one of each if you're still not sure, because it doesn't have to be a big thing that's like Uber or something. Just this whole thing, like just show you that I can actually code, you know. So yeah, I think just build up your portfolio and yeah, take it from there. And you can find me on Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, and YouTube. It is at the Tsogofatso. No underscores, no spaces.
Okay, perfect. With the world of developers being so toxic, is it that toxic or that's just a myth?
I think it can be. Okay. I think it depends on you as a person. You need to kind of
set
find
boundaries.
That boundaries and balance. Because I know people that will work until like 1 a.m., especially with this thing of working from home. They just start working. And I think it's so easy to be pulled into the code if you're trying to fix something. You're just like, okay, I just want to finish this thing. I just want to, then it's all of a sudden it's like 1 a.m. So personally, because I do so much, I try to have my set boundaries. Like 5 o'clock, I'm done.
Yes, I've heard you saying that, and I'm like, but that is kind of unusual for the software engineering type of.
I think sometimes, for example, if I'm busy and really deep into something, I could probably go half past 5, 6 o'clock, but then I honestly try my best not to do that. It's possible, like, just I think if you kind of set your time accordingly, because you have the whole day to do everything, so yeah.
And then the company doesn't expect such such type of hard work as they'll place it.
I'm still in a junior role. I've never been expected to kind of put in the extra hours, extra work. But I know some of the senior guys at work, if maybe there is a problem, maybe on a Saturday, like the system is not doing what it's supposed to do, then they might be needed to kind of like jump in, do something. But yeah, I'd like to guess and hope that they do get paid extra for that.
Okay. I say, okay, thank you very much for coming through, and we really did learn a lot. I think it's a very interesting career field. Everybody's just like, oh, software engineering, this and that, and most of us really don't understand much about it. But thank you for sharing your insight and shedding some light. Bye.
Bye.